Hello everyone. Today let's do lesson 6 from your textbook in English for class 8 Honeydew. And the chapter is This is Jody's Phone, written by Marjorie Kinnan Rowling. This chapter has been split into two videos. This is Jody's Phone is a story about a child's emotional preoccupation with a phone whose mother had to be killed to save his father's life. The story highlights values such as compassion and justice, care and concern for human and animal life. Chapter This is Jody's Phone has been taken from the famous book The Yearling, written by Marjorie Kinnan Rowling. Marjorie Kinnan Rowling was born on 8th August 1896 in Washington, D.C. She died on 14th December 1953 in United States, Florida. Marjorie Kinnan Rowling was an American author who lived in rural Florida and wrote novels with rural themes and settings. Her best-known book, The Yearling, about a boy who adopts an orphaned fawn, won a Pulitzer Prize for fiction in 1939 and was later made into a movie of the same name. Now let's begin with chapter reading. Lesson 6, This is Jody's Phone, written by Marjorie Kinnan Rowling. Now first let me read the introductory segment for you. Often instead of rushing to the doctor to treat a small cut or burn, we find quick and effective cures using things available at home. Can you think of such home remedies for a cut on your knee? What do? When you get a cut on your knee, it is recommended you wash that area first with soap and water and cleanse it, rinse it well, and then you can apply some antibiotic cream on that. If you get a burn on your arm, immediate work that you have to do is rinse the burned area with cold water. Keep eyes over it. Then you can apply some toothpaste too for the cooling effect. If you are stung by a bee, if there is bee sting, what it is recommended, again you have to wash the area with soap and water, rinse it well, then you can put ice over the affected area. This will reduce the penetration of venom or poison more into your body. This will reduce venom penetration or absorption. So in this story, Jody's father has been bitten by a rattlesnake. He quickly kills a doe and uses its heart and liver to draw out the poison. Jody wonders what will happen to the little fawn left without a mother. This story has been fragmented into three parts. Let us take the first part now. Before I start explaining the chapter, let me give you a brief introduction about the characters or the protagonists that are portrayed in the story. Jody. He is a small boy. He feels bad for the fawn, which is alone in the forest without his mother. Ezra Baxter, that is Penny. He is Jody's father. Mrs. Baxter, Jody's mother. Millville and Deck Wilson, they are foresters who helped Jody in finding fawn in the forest. Now let's begin reading with the chapter. Jody allowed his thought to drift back to the fawn. Drift back means to go back. He could not keep it out of his mind. He had held it in his dreams, in his arms. He slipped from the table and went to his father's bedside. Here, Jody could not help But think about the fawn again and again, no matter how much he tried not to think about the fawn. Actually, he had held that fawn in his arms and in his dreams. He finally got up from the table to go to his father's bedside, where his father Penny was resting. His eyes were open and clear, but the pupils were still dark and dilated. Dilated means enlarged. Here, as his father was bit by rattlesnake, a very poisonous kind of snake, the poison is still in his body and his father feels weak. With his dilated eyes, that is enlarged and dark eyes, his father has less vision right now. So he went to see his father, who was bedridden. He was lying in his bed. Geordie said, "How are you feeling, Pa?" So as he reached his father, he asked his father, "How do you feel now?" "Just fine, son. Old Death has gone thieving elsewhere." "But wasn't it a close shave?" "Old Death has gone thieving elsewhere." Let's look at the meaning of this phrase. Here, "Old Death has gone stealing elsewhere." This statement is made by Penny to Geordie, who feels content that he is saved from death. He personifies death as a old thief who spared his life and went away to steal someone else's life. But wasn't it a close shave? Close shave means narrow escape. "I agree." So Geordie said, "Yes, Pa, I agree that it was a close shave." Penny said, "I'm proud of you, boy. The way you kept your head and did what was needed." Kept your head means stayed calm in difficult situation. Penny expressed how proud he was of Geordie for how he did not lose his cool and did what was necessary while staying calm. "Pa," so Geordie, standing near father's bedside, he asks, he calls out his father. Father says, "Yes, son." "Pa, do you recollect the doe and the fawn?" Doe means she deer. The female of deer is called doe, and fawn is the baby of doe. So he is asking, "Do you remember, do you recollect the doe and the fawn?" "I can never forget them. The poor doe saved me, that's certain." When Penny heard Geordie asking, "Pa, do you remember the doe and the fawn?" to which he responds that he can never forget about the poor doe that saved his life. "Pa, the fawn may be out there yet. It might be hungry and very scared." Geordie expressed his concern regarding the fawn, who might still be out there hungry and frightened as he was separated from his mother. "I suppose so," said his father. "Pa, I'm a big boy now and don't need to drink milk. Why don't I go and see if I can find the fawn and bring it here and raise it?" So Geordie further adds that he can take care of him and he does not need milk anymore as he is grown up now. He asks his father if he could go and look out for the fawn and could bring that fawn home and can bring take care of the fawn and bring that fawn up. Penny lay quiet, staring at the ceiling. So without knowing what to respond to the boy, to the little boy, Penny lay quiet. He did not respond anything. "Boy, you have got me hemmed in." Hemmed in means caught in a situation where one can't say no. So Penny is not able to refuse the desire of Geordie. So he's telling that you have hemmed me. I'm not in a position to refuse. "It won't take much to raise it, Pa. It will soon start eating leaves and acorns." Acorns means small brown nuts, which are cheaply available. So he's telling that, Pa, it won't cost much to raise a fawn. It will soon start eating green leaves and acorns. So it will be easy. It will grow by itself. You are smarter than boys of your age. So we took its mother and it wasn't to be blamed. So he's telling that, father is telling that you are grown up enough. You are smart enough for your age. And Jordi is telling that we have taken its mother, we killed its mother, but we cannot blame it. We were in a situation where we were forced to kill the doe. Surely, it seems ungrateful to leave it to starve, son. I can't say no to you. I never thought I would live to see another day. So the father is telling, yes, it will be ungrateful. It will not be fair if we leave that fawn alone in the forest to starve and die. So he's telling, son, I cannot say no to you. You do as you wish. I never thought I will be able to see another day. It is only because of the doe whose blood, whom we killed and took the blood to extract the poison from my body. Because of that doe, I am able to see the next day. Can I ride back with Millville and see if I can find it? This is what Jordi asks his father. Tell your ma, I said you can go. So here Jordi asks his father if he could go and ride back with Millville to try and find the fawn. His father agreed and told Jordi to convey to his mother that he has given him the permission to go and find the fawn. He sidled back to the table and sat down. His mother was pouring coffee for everyone. Sidled means walked back quietly, trying not to be noticed. He said, Ma, Pa says I can go bring back the fawn. She held the coffee pot in mid-air. What fawn? The fawn belonging to the doe we killed. We used the doe's liver to draw out the poison and save Pa. She gasped. Pa says it would be ungrateful to leave it to starve. Doc Wilson said, that's right, ma'am. Nothing in the world comes quite free. The boy's right and his daddy's right. Millville said, he can ride back with me. I will help him find it. So here, Jordi went back to the table in the manner to avoid getting noticed. He told his mother while she poured coffee for everyone that his father has given him permission to bring the fawn. On hearing this, she paused and held the coffee pot in air and asked which fawn he is talking about. Jordi informs her that he intends to bring the fawn that belonged to the doe they killed to save his father's life. He further explained that they used doe's liver to extract poison to save his father. She heaved a sigh as she said that he can bring him home out of pure compassion. Jordi told her that his father thinks it would be ungrateful and unappreciative of them to let the fawn starve. Dr. Wilson kept his view forward by agreeing with what Jordi and his father said. He thought both of them were right. He further added that there is nothing you can get from the world for free. Millville volunteered to give Jordi a ride and help him find the fawn. She set down the pot helplessly. Well, if you will give it your milk, we have nothing else to feed it. On hearing all this, Jordi's mother felt helpless as she sat down. Even though she was not in favor of it, she knew they were right and thus agreed if Jordi would give the fawn his share of milk as they had nothing else to feed it. Millville said, "Come on, boy, we have got to get riding." Ma Baxter asked anxiously, "You will not be gone long." Jordi said, "I will be back before dinner for sure." Melville mounted his horse and pulled Jordy up behind him. He said to Melville, "Do you think the fawn's still there? Will you help me find him?" As soon as his mother agreed, Melville asked Jordy to come along and said that they need to go. Jordy's mother, Baxter, quite uneasily asked for reassurance that he will not be gone for long. Jordy replied that he would be back before dinner. Melville climbed his horse and helped Jordy to sit behind him. Jordy asked Melville if he thinks the fawn would still be there and if he will help Jordy in finding him. "We will find him if he is alive." "How do you know it's a he?" "The spots were all in a line. On a doe fawn passes, the spots are every which way." Every which way means in different directions. So Melville assured him that they would find the fawn if it was alive. However, he asked Jordy how he knew it was a male. Jordy told Melville that he is sure because his spots were all in a line. His father had told him that doe fawn or a female deer has spots in different directions. So I have shown you the picture of she fawn and he fawn. You can study the pattern of spots on the body of this fawn, doe fawn. Here the spots are all in different directions, every which way. But here the spots are in particular pattern, in proper lines. So by seeing the spots on the body of fawn, you can make out whether it's a he fawn or a she fawn. Thank you, students. We will continue part 2 and part 3 in video 2.